Hello?
Kelly, can you hear us?
Yes.
Awesome.
Oh, my goodness. I thought, uh-oh, something's wrong.
I just had messaged you. I'm like, oh, my God, I don't think she can hear us.
I better get off my computer and check Twitter and see if you guys are yelling.
No. Actress Kelli Maroney, how you doing?
Hi. How are you doing?
Good.
Great to be here. Thank you for calling.
Thanks for coming on. You're an actress, voice actress, and producer from L.A., correct?
That sounds about right, yeah.
I was going to say, too, you're originally from Minnesota, right?
I am. I was born there, yeah.
What made you go to L.A.? Was it just the acting bug?
Well, when I was a teenager, I went to a conservatory school because I had graduated early, and I really wanted to do that. And so my mom was oddly supportive of it because, you know, I was the last kid, and she had given up. she knew. I mean, she said, you know, if you want to do something, you should just do it.
Just go on.
And as a matter of fact, even if I was scared to do it, it was too late. I had to go do it. I remember calling her and saying, I want to go home, and she'd said, you stick it out. You stick it out. And so I did. I was on a soap opera. I accidentally got a soap opera. And so, I mean, I was in Manhattan with $500 to my name. I couldn't get an apartment or a job or anything. I accidentally got a soap opera. And I was scared to death. You know, this was, but, you know, there was no turning back. It was just such a, it's an unbelievable story that would never, ever happen. I mean, in a million years would happen.
Just
but it did.
Sink or swim, yes.
And so I was in New York for that. And then, you know, because I was working, I got an opportunity to go out for, you know, other movies and things like that because I was on people's radar. So I ended up in Los Angeles, but I went to New York first and was going to be a classical actress. So if you want to hear God laugh, tell him your plans.
we need to back up here because how do you accidentally get a role?
Well, okay, so I didn't have any place to live, and so I didn't have any money either. So this apartment rental agency lady took pity on me, and I know that in retrospect, she was like, oh my gosh, you know, this kid's going to end up on the Minnesota Strip, which is a little area of Manhattan where they kidnap young girls from the Midwest and turn them out. There's a movie about it. Eric Robert plays a pimp. Anyway, I digress. She said, you know, I can probably try to find you a roommate, but you're going to have, you know, I had nothing, right? And so she said, I know somebody, I have a friend who's an agent, and she tells me that they're casting a Midwestern Lolita on a soap, and they're having trouble finding her. Why don't you go see her? So I went to see her. Her office was the size of a closet, and not what you'd, I mean, you know, central casting would make it like one of those scary offices, but she said they're closed now. Why don't you slide? I had a 8x10 picture of myself. One, it wasn't even a headshot. Slide it under the door, and we'll see what happens. What have we got to lose? And so, sure enough, I got an audition, and just I was terrified, but it was just so outrageous that it happened.
Wow!
And then, you know, calling my mom, going, "Guess what? I'm going to be on TV in 2 weeks." it's an unbelievable story.
That is,
I know,
crazy.
And all I can think of is the universe said she will give up unless we do something right away. Otherwise, she's just going to give up.
You went
or
to get an apartment.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. That is. That, it couldn't have worked out any better. I was going to ask too. Is soap opera acting, is that like, I'm sorry, Kelly, I was going to ask, is soap opera acting, is that something that's like you're happy doing, or is it like, do you know, is this like a stepping stone?
Well, I knew it was a stepping stone because all the actors that were on it were, you know, very discontent. And,
okay.
Everyone told me, you know, don't buy any property because then they'll have you. And, you know, I mean, yeah, they said, you're young. This is not going to be your last job. Come on. And so I thought that way. I wanted to be Betty Davis. I wanted to be in the movies.
Mm.
It's actually my, you know, but it was important to go to New York first for training because I figured I would be taken more seriously and get a better foundation.
Wow.
And so, but the soap was not what I had in mind, actually.
Mm.
However, it was the best possible training I could have had. because it's every single day and they keep throwing changes at you and it's like, better cry on cue or you're fired.
So, really?
You know,
wow.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, I thought my whole first year on the soap was, I can't get fired. I can't get fired. I can't get fired. My whole family will never overcome the shame and humiliation.
Oh, wow.
Especially not me.
Or be in a coma. You don't want to be cast as like you're in a coma. Then that could, you could just be in that role.
That happened.
Forever.
It was the greatest thing ever because it was 2 weeks. I didn't have to learn any lines. I didn't have to get into makeup. I could just go there and you know, lay there like death warmed over. And everybody was crying over my body. As a matter of fact, I fell asleep one time. And when I woke up, they were breaking down the sets and everything. The stage manager, Briggsy, had forgotten I was there. And I could have gotten locked in there overnight. I said, Briggsy, you forgot about me. And he did. They just forgot I was there.
Wait, you really were in a
coma? You had a
coma
week?
No, I just fell asleep. Because if I was awake, yeah, then I was tempted to cry because, you know, I would hear the scene going on and all the other actors, like, you know, performing and stuff. And it would be moving. I remember seeing one woman, one actress, they killed her off. And she was supposed to be dead, but she couldn't stop having tears coming out of her eyes. And I just remember the director yelling at her, "You're dead! Stop crying!"
Wow.
It's a rough crowd, you know.
Wow, yes!
So I thought, I'm better off if I just, like, you know, go away in my mind, and I fell asleep.
Wow.
For real.
Yes. Wow.
So,
usually,
otherwise, you're just thinking, I hope my face isn't twitching. I hope, you know, I
yeah,
hope this is, people are buying that I'm in a coma.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's wow, the best training you could possibly have because you're in there every day.
Teaches you to be on
you
your
know?
Feet.
And,
yes.
And so when I got out to California, I mean, whether by design or just by instinct, the people that were casting, you know, all those kids in the 80s, those of us who had soap opera training would come in and we'd know our lines and we'd learn our blocking and they'd shoot one and they'd say, okay, we got that one. Now one for safety, as they say, just in case something went wrong that they didn't notice. And we would say, we get to do it again? We'd be so thrilled because we never got to do it again on the soap.
Oh.
You didn't stop tape. You could get in trouble.
Wow.
That's what
so
I was going to
we
say.
So
there were no retakes in,
wow,
in soap
yeah
opera. It was
no,
just like, you're
you know
on the
what
job.
The set could fall down behind you and you better keep going.
Wow.
Because if you stop tape, it costs the network a lot of money.
Wow.
So just, it doesn't matter what happens. Keep going.
Just keep going.
And so, you know, film is so different, but when we got on set, that's all we knew how to do. And so, you know, it was a breeze for them. They didn't have budgets for us to be like hanging out trying to get a scene all day long. And we would go like the wind, and then therefore so could they. So I don't know if they thought, hey, let's mine all the soap operas for talent. They didn't. I don't think they were thinking that, but
no,
it happened. It just so happened that it worked out great.
Wow.
I don't know if you've ever been on a set where things, you know, where it's going really slowly, the stress level is crazy because, you know, everybody that's trying to do it is freaking out because they're not getting it right. And then everybody on the production side is freaking out because they're going behind and it's costing money.
Yeah, that's what I would imagine.
It's a bad scene.
Wow.
So I'm more curious about the soap opera thing, because this is all very interesting. So was there a lot of improv that would go on during a soap opera?
Absolutely not. No
improv. You just
needed
to know your lines and you had to nail them. And you had one chance to nail them.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
And so, and it's a muscle. If you're doing that every day, you can look like at a whole page full of dialogue and know it. And it's not that you're magic. It's anyone can do that pretty much.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you're not doing it every day, then you have the same problem everybody else has, which is, do I know my lines? I mean, every time I do a play, right, I'm standing up there to go out and I go, I'm afraid I'm going to forget a line. Like, do I know this? And I think, you know, most of us do that. But on the soap, there's no time to think.
Yeah. Kelli, I was going to ask. I'm sorry.
I was really lucky because the woman that played my mother, she could have squashed me like a bug. She could have had me for breakfast. But she didn't. And she was a really strong actress, you know, and very powerful.
Yes.
And she instead took mercy on me and taught me how to do it.
That's amazing. She, like, yeah, showed you the way. She took you under her wing. Yeah, that's awesome.
A lot of those soap actors are just like, you know, sink or swim, babe.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking when you explained it. It's like, yeah, you either got it or you don't.
Yeah, they really, all you're doing is taking storyline away from them, so they can't wait for you to get lost anyway.
Just,
but
yes.
I mean, she's wonderful. She's one of my most loved people in my world today, even.
Wow, that's amazing. Kelli, I wanted to ask, too, when you got Fast Times, when you got cast for that, did you know it was mm-hmm. going to be as big of a movie when you were acting in the scenes? Did you think it was going to be as big as it was?
I did. I really did. I read the book before the audition, and I thought, this is amazing.
Wow.
I was a big reader anyway. I loved it. And so I was auditioning for Stacy. That's who they called me in for. So I had callback after callback. There was one day when they had me and Phoebe Cates and Brian Backer to the casting office, and Cameron Crowe and Amy Heckerling, and I mean, everybody was there.
Wow.
And we read the entire movie, and they ordered us lunch and everything. And it was really weird. But I don't know what they were. I mean, I'm pretty sure they already had Jennifer Jason Leigh here, but I guess they liked me enough to use me that day, because I didn't get it, and I really kind of think they already had her in the first place.
Yes.
But they called me, and then my agent said, "You didn't get it," and I was like, "Oh, too bad." But then they said they want to know if you will come and play the cheerleader, but you have to fly yourself out there and put yourself up. And I was like, the cheerleader? Because up to that point, I'd gotten a movie and I was on the soap, and I always played a juvenile delinquent.
I was going to ask if you ever were like
a... In my only movie, I was a little psychotic killer that killed a guy, and that's how that movie opened. And I was a bad girl on the soap.
Yeah.
So when they said, "Do you want to play the cheerleader?" I was like, "What are you talking about? You have the wrong number, you know?"
Wow.
Yeah, it was really weird. I couldn't wrap my brain around it, but of course I did. It was the best decision I ever made.
I was going to ask if that was like you, if you were just a bubbly person, like if that was like what they thought you'd be perfect at.
Well, I don't know. Something to the effect of, we don't think Kelli would not have these problems. And it's because, you know, people have a vibe about you. It's like, that's why I ended up getting so much Final Girl stuff, I think. People just think things about you. And it doesn't, you could just be sitting there breathing, but people will form opinions about you. They'll pick up a vibe on you, and there's nothing you can do about that.
Yeah, you're going to do whatever they see you as.
If people don't vibe you as a Final Girl, it doesn't matter what you do, you're going to get an axe on the forehead every time.
Wow.
You know, you'll be... I don't know. People cast on their gut emotions, and they just didn't feel that I personally would have those problems that Stacy had, Jennifer Jason Leigh, they felt would.
Yes. Wow. That's an amazing story.
Yeah, acting, the whole profession is really, I find it fascinating. Maybe it's not to other people, but I think it is. There's no rhyme or reason to it, and a lot of it is heart and gut instinct.
Yeah.
When all is said and done. So I got there, and there's just a magic on the set, and who was it? Oh, God, somebody always reminds me of this. My first day on the set, and who was it? It was... Art Linson, or Irving Azar, one of the two. I got on the set, and I was just looking to see what they were shooting, and it was the scene where Sean Penn and his friends, you know, roll out of the van, and there's all this smoke billowing out of it.
Yes.
That was the scene. And I'd read the whole book, you know, so I'm standing there, and I go, the cruising vessel! And somebody goes around, like, oh, finally, somebody's got some enthusiasm around here. And, of course, at that moment, I realized, of course, they cast me as the cheerleader. Duh.
That's how it happened.
Duh. They saw it before I did.
Yes.
And, you know, I mean, Yeah, I mean, but that moment I went, oh, man, they know something I don't know.
That is. That's something they saw. They saw that in you.
I go, the cruising vessel. And they went, who said that? And of course, it was me.
That's amazing. Do you still keep in touch with any of the actors and actresses from that film?
Amanda and Robert Romanus and... you know, like, what I mean, on social media once in a while, like Amy Heckerling's on social media, and I've run into Judge Reinhold. I've not run into anybody else, though.
Wow.
I did run into Anthony Edwards one time, and he didn't recognize me right away. And I said, Anthony, and he got this look on his face like, oh, my God, who the hell is this? And I went, it's Kelly from Fast Times. And he's like, oh.
Thank God. Yeah,
nice
it's
to
agree.
See you not get lost. Yeah.
I love
and who the hell know who I thought he thought I was. But yeah.
Yes, you weren't that, so that was good. It was good. Wow.
So, but I had this feeling, and it could be because I couldn't drive yet, so... my choices were, you can get picked up by the Teamsters, and they'll give you a ride to the set, or
yes.
You can figure out your own way. And I couldn't drive, and I didn't know where I was or anything. So they picked me up, but they picked me up at the crack of dawn, because that's when they were going.
Yes.
And so I got to watch Universal Studios come to life in the morning. I'd be sitting there, and like we were like the first people on the set, on the lot, the entire lot. And then pretty soon you'd see wardrobe coming, and you'd see the catering trucks, and you'd start to smell the food, and lights would go on, and all of a sudden those little carts are riding around everywhere. And
yes.
It was the most majestic thing I've ever seen in my life. You know, someday if I ever direct a musical, I'm going to have that happen.
Yes.
But I'd be there hours early, so I would sit in the makeup trailer, and I think, well, I'm gonna get fixed up at least, and there would be Sean sitting there getting his extensions in, and that was the few. I mean, he was in character the whole movie.
Yes.
But when in the morning, when he's sitting there getting his extensions in, and he probably was like, oh crap, because. He just wanted to be himself for the time being, and then I was there, and I was a cast member, so he didn't say much around me. But the hair lady, the lady who's doing the hair, said, "You kids ought to be nicer to Sean. He's a nice boy." But he was purposefully alienating himself from us.
Yes.
You know? So we were like, "What's up with this guy?"
Wow.
He's a nice boy. You guys be nice to him.
You guys, yeah. You be nicer to Sean Penn.
Wait, why was he alienating himself? I'm not getting
I was just going to say, did he feel
he
like he was
character.
Better than you, or
he
was he in character? Okay.
Oh, okay. So just, I guess he wanted to also make you guys think, like, this is who I am, kind of keep you guys in character as well, if you didn't really see who he was.
Right. He didn't want to get too comfortable with us, and he didn't, and we all thought he was weird, and that's how all the kids thought about Spicoli, so... It was a method choice.
Yes, he was like that. I was going to ask you too, Kelly, we got to start wrapping this up, but do you have any projects that are upcoming that you could talk about?
Well, I do. I have a movie coming out called Exorcism at 60,000 Feet. Guess what it's about?
On a plane?
Yeah, it's a cross between The Exorcist, Snakes on a Plane, and Airplane.
Oh, that is
and
awesome.
And then humor is... Yeah, the humor
great.
Is really sick and wrong,
yeah.
And I couldn't believe some of the things they were actually doing. But
wow.
I mean, you just have to laugh and say, okay, let's shoot it then.
Yes.
But Lance Henriksen, Bill Moseley, Adrian Barbeau, Kevin O'Connor, Bai Ling, you know, the usual suspects were all on this plane. So you can just tell by when the plane starts filling up, something. Awful is going to happen because we're all sitting in.
Oh, that sounds great.
And I did a short film too. I don't know about getting a mainstream release, but it was with some really good people, which I'm not supposed to say anything about. But
okay.
So there's that. And I have two things. One, I'm shooting the first part of next year called To Avenge, and it's a thriller, and it's very topical. It's like the Me Too thing, and I play it. An awful bitch in it. And yeah, and the other one I don't think I'm supposed to say anything about, but
okay.
it's I'm really enjoying this part of, you know, now that I'm a middle-aged lady, and a lot of people would say, well, you know, there's just not parts for older women, but you know what, there are.
Yes.
there's plenty of parts for, like, you know, the mom you'd like to, you know.
I was just going to say, yeah, and that, and that's great
and
to
evil
hear you say that.
Evil women, and for a long time I hit this thing where I wasn't really believable as a grown woman because I was so well known as that 80s kid. No matter what I did to my hair, it was like, oh, yeah, I know who she is. Well, no, you don't, and I can't play the kid anymore. But, you know, it was hard for me to become current in people's minds.
Yes,
but,
you were still
finally, it's working.
You were still Cindy in their mind.
So you did get typecasted for a while then.
Yeah.
Well, it was, you know, I have the honor and the joy and the luck, and it's blind good fortune.
Yes.
To be recognized for a decade. I mean, I was in Fast Times, and I was in Night of the Comet, and I was in Chopping Mall. I mean, and those are three of the most iconic 80s movies. All the movies from the 80s are iconic, but those are ones that it's really hard to separate me from.
Yes.
And so it took me a lot of work to get people to pay attention to me in the present day. So I'm really happy that they are now. Finally.
That's great. Kelli, thank you so much.
I mean, I'll never replace those golden years of being, you know, when you're a kid, you get all those great parts. However, this is going to be just as sweet. I know you have to go. I could talk your ear off, but I just wanted to say thank you for having me.
Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
No problem, Kelli. We will definitely have you back on. Absolutely.
All right.
So,
all right, thank you very much. Enjoyed talking at you, everybody.
where can everybody find you?
Kisses to you, too. I'll talk to you later.
Kelli, where can everybody find you?
Oh, gosh. Okay. I'm on Twitter at, I'll spell my name. Everyone spells it wrong, including True Blood. When my credit, they spelled my name wrong. It's KelliMaroney. Twitter at Kelli Maroney. Actress Kelli Maroney on Facebook. Kelli Maroney Instagram. I tend to use my name just so it's easy. However, my YouTube is Loves Nerds.
Loves Nerds. Awesome,
yeah,
Kelli.
Yeah, you can find me from Kelli Maroney, too, but it's Loves Nerds.
Thank you, Kelli.
Thanks a lot. It was great talking to you.
Great talking to you. Have a good one.